Well, I'm especially happy about the few of you that said good morning, even when it wasn't in a microphone. So good morning to you. Let's sing together the praises of our God as we begin our worship time together today. Let's sing this together. Singing, oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Now, the fountain, oh, I am washed, I am drenched in love. Our souls atoned by the blood of the Lamb. I'm not a slave to what's held me damned. How beautiful that cleansing flood. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. Oh, singing, oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fountain, I know. I am washed, I am drenched in love. Once shackled me, how infinite that grace divine. I am free, I am free, I am a child of God. Singing, oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Oh, no other fountain, no, I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. 'Cause I was buried deep with Christ my Lord, and now I'm raised to life forevermore. My name's been carved upon your heart. No, not death, no, not hell could ever rip us apart. Singing, oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fountain, no. I am washed, I am washed, I am drenched in love. Oh, 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 oh
makes me white as snow. No other fountain, no, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Amen. If you've been redeemed by the blood of Jesus, say amen. Amen. We are so glad to be here with you. And I tell you what, I would love for us to take just a moment this morning, and however you feel comfortable, with a wave, a handshake, a fist bump, a how do you do, a bow, whatever you want to do, find somebody this morning, make them welcome, tell them you're glad that they are here, and let's just greet each other in the love of Jesus.
Morning. You heard me? All right. Well, good morning. We'll have you all make your way back to your seats when you get the moment. What a wonderful group this morning. A group that is here in the love of Jesus and in the love of one another. And it is a privilege to welcome you here this morning into Louisville Grace Community Church of the Nazarene. My name is Pastor Daniel. And whether you have joined us here in person, which we got a lively group here in person, or whether you are watching us online, whether you're at lgcnaz.com or on our Facebook page, either way, what a pleasure it is, what a privilege it is to be able to worship with you today, and we welcome you into this place. There's a lot of stuff going on in this church, a lot of wonderful, positive things that I just want to share with you, a few announcements to share with you. First of all, everybody knows what today is. It is a day for treats and masks and hot chocolate and all kinds of other good stuff, and we are hosting our Trunk or Treat this evening from 6 o'clock to 8 o'clock, and we hope that you could be a part of it. Whether you just want to bring kids or grandkids and come and participate in it, or bring a neighbor or something like that, or if you would like to actually participate in the Trunk or Treat. We've had several people that have signed up to begin decorating trunks that kids will begin to go through and get candy and all of that from, and there's even some contests for best trunks, so you want to put your effort into it. Here's what I will tell you. If you were looking at this today saying, ooh, you know, I know I didn't tell you guys that I wanted to be a part of it, but I still want to be involved. I would love to decorate a trunk today. Well, guess what? You still can. You can be a part of our trunk or treat. The signups are still out in the foyer. We just kind of want to know how many cars to expect to make room for. And so if you put your name down and you say, man, I don't even know what to decorate. Just throw some balloons in there and put a bowl of candy out, and it's perfect. And so it'll be awesome. Decorate a trunk. The more, the merrier. And honestly, this is what a wonderful way to come face-to-face with community people that otherwise would not darken the doors of our church. And so it really is. It's fun, but it's outreach too. Come to our trunk retreat. It'll be a lot of fun. Sign up in the foyer today. I do want to remind you that we have our fall renewal week coming up very soon. with Kenny Greenway. If you have never heard Kenny Greenway speak, man, I tell you what, the power of God flows through this man, and he knows the scripture backward and forward. What a wonderful person to lead and usher in a movement of the Holy Spirit in this church. And so I encourage you, if there is any way possible, block off this time from the 14th to the 17th where Kenny Greenway will be in here. You will not regret it. God will intervene in your life, and he will do some amazing things. And so I just want to remind you of that. Hey, guess what? Our fellowship meals are starting to come back, and it is roughly, how long is it until Thanksgiving? We've got about a month, maybe a little bit less than a month till Thanksgiving. We want to celebrate together. We want to eat together and enjoy a fellowship meal together. And so November 14th, guess what? That's also the first day of Fall Renewal with Kenny Greenway. We want to welcome him in with style, so we're going to have a shared meal together. If you want to be a part of that, you can join up in the foyer. We want to know, again, how many to expect. There's a lot of stuff. Just start signing papers out in the foyer. Don't even look at them. Just put your name on them. And you can be part of anything that we do here in this place. So that'll happen on the 14th. So mark your calendars. 14th is a great day. Now, several of you. Yeah, oh, by the way, that Thanksgiving meal is catered. Thank you, sweetheart. So you don't have to bring anything to it. That will be taken care of. So it's gratis, and you can enjoy that. You probably saw out in the foyer that there are Christmas boxes sitting out. And if you have been around here for more than, you know, a couple of months, you probably know that we join up with Operation Christmas Child, and so that involves the packing up of boxes for kids who will get gifts that they will cherish for the rest of their lives. And so if you want to become more involved in that, just know that there is a packing party going on November 18th. And in the meantime, if you want to help contribute supplies to that packing party to make sure that every box is filled with the stuff that needs to be in it, there are ornaments out on the tree in the lobby. You can grab an ornament that has different supplies that you need in order for us to get all the materials together for this packing party. We're going to change kids' lives. And so if you want to be a part of that, put the date down. Boy, that week is booked up, isn't it, all the way from Sunday to Thursday? But I tell you what, it is a life-changing week. And so we want you to participate in the movement of God. So do not forget that day. Also, man, I want to invite you. Our kids are already preparing something really special for our church. They're putting together a play for you, and we are going to have an entire evening of Christmas theater. There will be music. There will be performance. There will be dinner. There will be wonderful things downstairs in our fellowship hall, and we would love everyone here to be in attendance for that, to support our kids, to celebrate Christmas, to enjoy something festive, something that we've missed for the last couple of years while the world has been kind of shut down. And so come join us December 15th. That'll be roughly 6 to 6:30. We'll figure out the exact time. We'll put that down very soon, but it'll be in the evening time. So mark down December 15th. We'd love for you to join in that as well. I have one more announcement that's not part of here, but I want to call up Mima Beams if you want to come forward here for just a moment. Now, some of you in this church already know that October is Pastor Appreciation Month, and I don't think that there is any better way to cap off a Pastoral Appreciation Month than to appreciate one who is being licensed in the Church of the Nazarene to carry the gospel. And so Mima, she and Wes came back from Florida just a couple of months ago, and Mima instantly started asking me questions about how she can get involved, how she can serve. And so we got into a long conversation after that about really where God felt like he was leading her. And before we knew it, we started talking about, God, I think, has been leading. Yeah, I think you were telling me, God has been leading me, I believe, into vocational ministry for a long time, and I just haven't taken that step. And so through that process, Mima is beginning to take classes to study for ministry in the Church of the Nazarene. And it was not long ago that our board approved Mima's very first local minister's license in the Church of the Nazarene. You're going to start seeing Mima beginning to serve and take leadership in different roles around the church. And we want to congratulate you on taking this journey. So, yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You will never forget your first.
No.
Frame it, put it on the wall, whatever you want to.
Yes.
That is something very special in the beginning, I believe, of a holy journey for you. And so we celebrate with you and cannot wait to see how God grows you in your ministry as you begin to put it to use, you begin to take in the education. I believe he's going to explode in you powerfully. And so we love you, Mima. Thank you so much. Yes. And I believe Bruce had something he wanted to share before we get going as well. So.
Okay, to sum up the announcements, sign up, come, and eat. That's just the announcements. What I wanted to say is, as Pastor just now mentioned, it's Pastor Appreciation Month, and we appreciate our pastors. So if Pastor Allie would come up front and Pastor Daniel would come here, the church board would like to show our appreciation in a monetary form. We appreciate you all. We love you all. And we don't know where this church would be without you. We couldn't do anything without you all. You all are just awesome. Also, there are baskets out in the foyer. If you brought a card, please drop it in the baskets out there today, or if you didn't bring it today, the baskets will remain out there till next week or the week after, because November is the month of Thanksgiving, and we're very thankful for our pastors. So put their cards in the baskets out there, and you all feel free to pull your cards out of your basket. Thank you.
I never know quite how to continue after something like that, and to say that we love you too, and what a privilege it is to serve this wonderful community. I see all the faces around here, and I'm just blown away by what God is doing in this church.
Thank you, everyone.
Yeah, by your generosity and your goodness. Y'all have loved us in ways I can't even comprehend. I want us to go back into a time of praise together. I ask that you would join me in prayer. Lord, we are thankful, for you are good and you are holy. You are our source and our provider. You are everything that you claim that you are. And Lord, so much more that we can't even begin to put into words. And so we thank you for grace unending, for love unfailing, for joy unending, for hope, Lord, that sustains. So we love you for who you are, and it is in that wonderful name of Jesus that we pray. And the church said together, amen. Would you stand? Let's continue to give him praise. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of Glory, the King of Glory, rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of Glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. You would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Oh, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Oh, and worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. Set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. I want to read this morning just one verse from 1 Corinthians, chapter 18. And it's just this. I'm sorry, chapter 1, verse 18. It says, "For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." And this morning, I think about what that means. It means that because he died and because he rose, we have life. We have hope. And the other half of that is that without that, what we believe means nothing. And so I want us to sing this song together. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow, and for no other reason. Let's give him glory. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. God sent his son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He bled and died
garden. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lived. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future, and life is worth the living just because He lives. Nothing to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy He gives. But greater still, the calm assurance this child can face uncertain days, because He lives, because He lives. I can face tomorrow, because He lives. All fear is gone, because I know He holds the future, and life is worth the living just because He lives. And then one day I'll cross that river, I'll fight life's final war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory, and I'll know He reigns, because He lives. I can face tomorrow, because He lives. All fear is gone, because I know He holds the future, is worth the living just because He lives. Because I know He holds the future, and life is worth the living just because He
We give You thanks, Lord. Church, you can be seated for just a minute. I'm going to call our ushers forward as we prepare to receive our tithes and our offerings. And I want us to remember that this is worship. This is not another element of our service. This is not something that we separate from what we already do when we lift up praises to our God, when we pray to Him, when we sing songs, when we do all these other things in His name, that this is another way that we acknowledge and worship the God who has given us everything that we own. And so we respond by giving back a portion of what He has already blessed us with. So may this be worship for us. I want to let you know that if you forgot a checkbook or anything like that, there are options for giving online. You can go on our app, our app at LGC. You can go to our website at lgcnaz.com, or you can download our phone app at Louisville Grace Community, and you can use the giving options on there. Either way, we want to worship the Lord this morning in the way that we give. And I just ask that You would pray with me again. Lord, we declare our belief in You, not just as someone who lived a good life and taught a bunch of good things, but one who is truly Lord of all. And so we respond in belief, Lord, by giving You even of what sustains us, because we know that the one who truly sustains us is You. So be blessed, Lord, in this. Be honored and glorified in the giving of our offering. For it is in Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. What a wonderful name in which to put our trust. And it is not a mistake that we sang that song this morning, as what we believe about Jesus is central, and our kids are going to learn some central things about Jesus this morning. And so, kids, if you're part of this, I know you've been raring probably to go with Pastor Allie downstairs to children's church, and so you're dismissed. You think they like children's church? I may go down there too. Y'all are dismissed. That just seemed like the right idea. I want us to just sort of calibrate ourselves a little bit before we go into our message today. Kind of know where we're at. We had been for a very long time going through the entire Gospel of Luke in a series called Dear Theo. Of course, Luke was written to Theophilus, and of course, so is the book of Acts, which we'll go through afterward. And so just Dear Theo for short. But we got to a passage in Luke chapter 17 where Jesus is addressing those who will be looking for him to return. Of course, one of the central things that we believe in the church is that Jesus was resurrected from the dead, and he made appearances to folks, and then he rose to be at the right hand of God the Father, where he is right now, but he is returning, and he's talking about the longing for his followers to see the return of Jesus, to the Son of Man. And so he says this in Luke chapter 17. He says to his disciples, "The time is coming when you will long to see one of the days of the Son of Man, but you will not see it. People will tell you, there he is, or here he is, but don't go running off after them. For the Son of Man in his day will be like lightning, which flashes and lights up the sky from one end to the other." It says, "But first he must suffer many things and be rejected by this generation." In other words, when people are beginning to look for signs of who Jesus is, for the return of Jesus, say, "Oh, I recognize him in this." He says, no, don't fall for other people who are going to be pointing at things and saying, "There's Jesus." He says, when it's Jesus, it'll be as obvious as a flash of lightning. But I tell you that in our time today, even though we have Bibles that are accessible more than any other time in human history, there is more confusion about who the real Jesus is than any time in human history. It's like we're getting faint signals of who Jesus is. We get just a little bit. We get bits and pieces, and we try to form a picture of who he really is based off what the world tells us. In fact, we got different pictures of who Jesus is that already begin to swirl through our minds as we picture him. And some of us think of sort of this traditional Jesus with the sacred heart and the pale skin. And some of us think of Jesus more as a buddy or a homeboy or someone that we're that's kind of our friend and just wants us to have a good and happy life. Some of us think of the historical Jesus. Some of us think of Carpenter Jesus. Some of us think of the movie Jesus. We have all of these different ideas of who Jesus is in our head, and all of them sort of come together to form this picture of who Jesus really is to us. Unfortunately, not all of those voices are right. And so for the last several weeks, we've been trying to hone in on who the real biblical Jesus is. You know, the first week we talked about him being not just, we know Jesus, the Son of God. If you're part of this church and you subscribe to what this church believes, we believe that Jesus is the Son of God. There is no negotiating that. And that is the way that he is described so often. But sometimes we forget Jesus refers to himself more often as Son of Man. Now, why would Jesus choose to refer to himself as Son of Man if he really is the Son of God? Because he is the one who identifies with humanity. He was a sacrifice for us, and he actually took our place, took punishment that we deserved. He identifies with humanity. He makes the link between God and humanity on our behalf, and we have to understand that Jesus is the one that makes the way for us. The week after that, we talked a little bit about how we think about sweet Jesus. I think I mentioned at one point the pictures that I see of Jesus. In fact, the old church that I grew up in or went to when I was young had this very sweet picture of Jesus holding a lamb with little flowers around the frame and all of that. And we think of Jesus just sort of this sweet influence in our lives. And he is. He's wonderful. He's precious. He's sweet. But there's also a fire to Jesus. We also understand that Jesus is fierce. He fights for us. And sometimes we need a fighter, not someone who's just going to hug us, but who's actually going to carry us through the flames and the waves and the wind and all these kinds of things. A Jesus who fights for us. We forget that there is power in the name of Jesus. Last week we talked about all the superlatives that we attach to Jesus. The supreme name of Jesus, and yet the one that he decided to take on himself was that of Lamb, that of sacrifice. But this whole series, it goes back to this question: who is Jesus? We could extend this series into the rest of the year and not touch the surface of who Jesus is. And so I want to make sure that we're really getting into to the things that are important. Who is Jesus? Who is he to you? Have you ever really, I think there comes a time in our life where we evaluate who Jesus is to us. We make a decision one way or the other, and maybe we get encountered with that question again and again, and we have to keep making a decision about what we believe about Jesus. But have you ever really sat down and considered, really, who is Jesus to you? What does he mean to you? What do you really believe about who Jesus is? Because I believe what we believe about Jesus 100% begins to express in our actions. Who is he to you? And why do you believe it? There was a study a few years ago by the Barna Group. If you're familiar with the Barna Group, they do all kinds of different demographic and church surveys. And they did a survey of basically all of the adult generations of the church. I know where Gen Z is starting to get into that. They didn't poll Gen Z. I would love to know the numbers on this. But they began to ask people the question that I just asked you. Who is Jesus to you? It was that simple, nothing more, nothing less. They pulled a bunch of people and said, who do you believe that Jesus is? Now, I've got some statistics up here for you, but who answered this question. Now we have the elder generation, the generation that's, I think what they also would call the greatest generation. There's not a whole lot of that generation left. A lot of them have already gone home to see their Lord. But of the ones that were polled that are of sort of that elder generation, 62% of that generation said that they believed that Jesus was God, the Son of God, the Supreme One. 18% of that generation said that they believed that Jesus was a great moral teacher. That there were a lot of things that you can begin to extract from what Jesus said that you can begin to apply to your life. And so it's a good thing to follow Jesus, because what he said is helpful for our lives. But they did not subscribe to the idea that he was God. And of course, the other 20% were not sure or believed something different, that he wasn't really of any sort of value in life. Now, you look down, and then they began to poll the baby boomer generation. And you see the percentage goes down, the amount of people that subscribe to the idea that Jesus was God. In fact, it went down by about 4%. Look at the rise in the amount of baby boomers that believe that Jesus was a good teacher, that there's some information that we can extract and apply to our lives. You go down again, another generation, a Generation X, and it drops another 3% of those who believe that Jesus was God. But look at the amount that it continues to increase, where folks are still taking some insight from Jesus and saying, wow, you know, some of the stuff he taught was really good. We can begin to apply this, but I don't know about him being God. You go down to the millennial generation, and it drops a pretty staggering percentage between this one, that less than half believe that he was the Son of God. But look at how many now begin to apply the teachings of Jesus as just sort of good information to have on hand, good ways to live your life. I noticed that the number barely changed in how many people believe he had no spiritual significance. In fact, you go through it, and the percent that believed that Jesus carried no significance in our lives was from the generations was 18%, 17, 17, 17. Very few people don't think that Jesus has any sort of value, but the amount of people that have begun to take Jesus down a rung and move him up into the area of a great moral teacher has really become something of a revolution in the way that we see Jesus. But yet from a generation that overwhelmingly believed in him, more and more are taking the route of saying that Jesus was just a good teacher. Now here, let's just give some examples of the good teachings of Jesus. I mean, you could take these things and apply them to your life, right? Let's look at some of the great teachings that Jesus gave us. How about this one from John chapter 8? He says, To the Jews who had believed, Jesus said, if you hold to my teaching, then you really are my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. What a wonderful thing. It's a reassuring thing to know that when you follow Jesus, you've got truth there. What about this from Matthew chapter 7? Oh, in everything do unto others what you would have them do to you, for this sums up the law and the prophets. My goodness, the golden rule was taken from Jesus' teaching. What a wonderful thing for him to say. How about this from Matthew chapter 5? You've heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. What a wonderful recipe for peace. Thank you, Jesus. What a wonderful teaching. How about this one from John chapter 6? Jesus said to them, very truly, I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last day. Well, I'm not going to put that in a picture frame in my home. Well, I mean, if you believe that Jesus is a good teacher, go ahead. Pick up cannibalism. Listen, that's not something that grandma wants to put on her pillow, all right? See, the truth is that the gospel, if you really absorb all of the teachings of Jesus, if you really read through who Jesus was and what he came to do, what he came to accomplish, it is full of things that Jesus said and did that were so outrageous that I think it is impossible for us to intellectually say that Jesus was a good teacher. Yes, there are some snippets that we can pull out that are encouraging from what Jesus said, some things that we can begin to apply to our lives that I think are wonderful things. However, anyone who claims to hold this belief that Jesus wasn't really the Son of God, but man, it's great to read what he says because I think we can apply that and we can begin to use these moral principles. I don't think that it holds much water for us to say that Jesus was a good moral teacher. They're so out there, they're so outrageous at times that he was a source of culture shock for the Jews that he began to fellowship with, and controversy for what he claimed about himself. If you understood the claims of Jesus, it's hard to separate one from the other and think, wow, okay, well, I'm just going to take this one third of what Jesus said and begin to apply it to my life. He claimed to be the only way to salvation. He claimed to be the only one who can offer forgiveness for sin. He claimed that he alone came to reconcile God back to sinful man. This is what Jesus came to do and what he claimed about himself. He made no qualms about it. He claimed that he was God. Who is Jesus to you? My favorite author, C.S. Lewis. I want you to let you know that the bulk of this message that I'm taking, the inspiration from it was not from my head, but it was from another much better mind than mine. And it is that of C.S. Lewis. Based on Jesus' claims, C.S. Lewis postulated this, and maybe you have heard this argument from him before, but he can either be one of three things. And it's really hard to draw a line between any of the rest of them. He is either one of three things. Either Jesus was wrong, and he knew he was wrong, which would make him a liar. Or Jesus was wrong and didn't believe that he was wrong, which would make him crazy. Or he really was God. No one could believe and claim the things that Jesus believed and be anything but unstable or evil or God. I mean, really, you put the whole thing together. So let's just think for a moment. Well, I'm going to play devil's advocate right here in the pulpit. Terrible thing to do, but let's do it anyway. Was Jesus a liar? See, I think that no matter what, if you read through the teachings of Jesus, you read through the historical accounts of what Jesus accomplished, even from just a historical perspective, that there are very few who would doubt the incredible intelligence of Jesus. Very clearly, he knew what he was doing. He drew a big following. He was charismatic. Wonderful things happened in his presence. Let's look for a moment in Luke chapter 4. Let's read this passage from verses 14 through 20. It says, Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and news about him began to spread through the whole countryside. He was teaching in their synagogues, and everyone praised him. He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom, and he stood up to read. And the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him, and unrolling it, he found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery for the sight of the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down, and the eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. What I can tell you is they don't just hand the scroll to anyone, first of all, in the synagogue. But he had already begun to be held as someone who had wisdom beyond his age and his understanding and his education level. He had gained a reputation early in his ministry for being well-learned. He taught, he read in synagogues, like we see in this passage. He reads in this passage from the text of Isaiah, which was about 500 or 600 years old, about this prophecy. And he says to them, and this is what I tell you, at the end of reading that, about talking about this restoration that is going to take place, this idea of what God is working in their midst, he says to them at the end of reading that passage, with the scroll open in front of all of them, he says to them, "I'm the one this scroll talks about. It is fulfilled here, right now, in your presence." Scholars debate which of the Old Testament texts are prophetic, but depending on your interpretation, hundreds or at least dozens of conditions had to be met for anyone to even reasonably make this claim. For someone to make the claim that they are the fulfillment of this text, they had to be born in the right place. They had to be of the right bloodline. They had to be descended from the root of Jesse, the root of David, and all the way down, and then you can trace Jesus' lineage. It's right there. So they had to be born in the right place. He had to have the right blood. He had to be from the right hometown, which he was. He had to eventually die. He had to eventually be raised. All of that was fulfilled. All of that met the criteria. Let me tell you, Jesus was no dummy. And he just so happened to have all of the right pedigree to make the claims. He had to know all of those things, too. What I want to tell you is that it would be very odd for someone to have that kind of following, to make that kind of claim, to have that kind of wisdom and intelligence, and still meet all of the criteria necessary. Hundreds and hundreds of prophecies about Jesus. Is it possible? Sure. It's also possible I'm about to sprout a third arm right here on the platform. You can't just rule out, though, that Jesus was simply a smart man who knew he had a chance to be worshipped because he fit the bill. But let me ask you this question, too. This is something that cannot be denied. Why would someone as intelligent as Jesus, why would he go to the grave for something he knew to be a lie? If he was lying, he either played the most costly and evil prank in history, or maybe he was just nuts. Well, let's think about that for a moment. We said that, okay, maybe Jesus was a liar, but that doesn't even really make sense. You look at the way he lived his life, and you look at the cost that it brought him. And honestly, Jesus could have at any moment called his followers to a rebellion, which could have maybe taken part of Rome back. He could have led a revolution right there. People were ready to go up in arms. He had zealots with swords ready to go and storm the emperor. He never did it. It just doesn't make sense. But let's look at this for a moment. So C.S. Lewis postulates that he was either a liar, a lunatic, or he was the Lord. So let's look at this lunatic idea for a moment. Did I mention that Jesus made the claim that he was God in the flesh? He was God incarnate. That alone, if that claim wasn't true, that would be enough to declare him insane. I mean, just think about this. Let's think, Anyone that you know, anyone that you've grown up with, suddenly, after 33 years, they start going around the countryside and saying, okay, I'm the fulfillment of everything that God has asked, and so come and follow me and come worship me. You would think that they were absolutely bonkers, right? Some of his claims actually drove people away. These are the passages that we don't hear preached too much because they're not incredibly inspirational. But some of the things that Jesus taught actually drove people away from him. We don't hear about that all the time. But it's true. I want to give you an example of this. Jesus, if you know the story of Jesus feeding like 5,000 people, and that's just the men in the group that they took count of. So you think about it, it's probably closer to 10,000 people that Jesus had taken some kids' lunch and divided it up between thousands and thousands of people and performed this wonderful miracle of basically making something out of nothing. He had fed this crowd. It was a great miracle. And that crowd, after this feeding, had followed Jesus across the lake and found him again. Jesus tried to get away from him. He tried to sort of have some alone time with the Father, but the crowds, they just kept following. They just kept following. And there are thousands of people that are just following in Jesus' footsteps here in this place. And then as the crowd begins to approach Jesus, this is in John chapter 6, if you want to know the reference, the crowd asked Jesus, what must we do to do what God requires? I'm assuming they didn't all say it at once. That would have been really odd if the whole crowd asked the question at the same time, but this question began to arise from them. Maybe someone shouted it from the back and said, what do we have to do in order to fulfill God's requirements? And the rest of the crowd says, yeah, we want to know. His first reply is that he came down from heaven to do God's will. And they begin to look around at each other and say, isn't this Joseph's kid? Wasn't he that carpenter's son? And he's saying he came down from heaven to do God's will? That's weird. And then we have that passage that I talked about a couple of moments ago in John chapter 6. I want to read the rest of it for you because that was just a snippet of what Jesus said. It said, Jesus said to them, very truly, I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last day, for my flesh is real food, and my blood is real drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in them. And just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so the one who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Your ancestors ate manna and died, but whoever feeds on this bread will live forever. He said this while teaching in the synagogue in Capernaum. They gave him a platform, and he says this. And on hearing this, many of his disciples said, whoo, this is hard teaching. Who can accept it? After all that you've done, this is what you say to us? Are you crazy? A few verses later in John 6, you can look it up if you want to. The account is that most of those who followed Jesus turned back to go home. Who can hear those kinds of words and be like, okay, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. What a great teacher. This is the same man, however, who had done the impossible in front of their eyes just hours before that. Feeding them something from nothing. See, to follow Jesus meant that one had to exhibit a radical faith. It's not just, okay, yeah, Jesus, you're cool and I'm cool and let's have this back and forth relationship. No, you had to be sold out. You had to believe everything, man. Raised as the son of a carpenter in a simple village, some of the people that were in that big crowd had probably changed his diapers as a kid. And now he's making all of these hard-to-digest claims. I mean, really, if you knew someone that began to make that claim, you would think he lost his mind, right? A man would have to be crazy to make the claims that Jesus did. Unless he was telling the truth. And here's what I can tell you. If all we believe is that Jesus was just a great moral teacher, someone who gave us some maxims that we can pass on,
to the next generation to try and live our life a little bit better. What that means is that you have to ignore the other stuff that Jesus has said. And I don't know about you, but it's real hard for me to try to take advice from someone crazy. But I will tell you this, in the end, even making claims like that, he sure did convince a lot of people that he was crazy. Or I'm sorry, he sure did convince a lot of people that he was God. That he was Lord. The people that Jesus left behind are maybe the most compelling argument for the only other option that's left. Yeah, maybe. Maybe he was a liar. Maybe he was a lunatic. What I can tell you is that there's no middle ground. Because you either believe one of those two things or you believe this next one. And he really was who he said he is. See, the best argument that I have for Jesus truly being who he is to look at the impact he had on those who knew and followed him. Is to look at the effect that it had on the entire world. Because there have been a lot of crazies that have come along that have claimed all kinds of things and asked people to come follow, and when they die, the whole movement stops. But when Jesus died, all it did was fuel the movement. What would compel the disciples of Jesus to continue his ministry if he had not truly raised from the dead? What would be their motivation for such a thing? To be reviled by everyone and rejected and despised and spit on because that's what happened to the one that they followed? Why would they want to continue that? Unless they really knew it, who he was. See, these men that at his arrest had scattered to the corners of the city so that no one would see them. These men like Peter, who physically denied him three times when anyone said, hey, are you one of those disciples of Jesus? No. I don't know the man. If you look into the history of these disciples that Jesus left behind, these 12, they indicate that all but one were horrifically crucified for what they believed. What would cause that kind of change? What would be worth dying that kind of death for? So let's think about those disciples. Let's think about the early church in Rome. The church in Rome was persecuted beyond all imagination and all belief. You read about the Emperor Nero and how he used the bodies of Christians, the martyrs of the faith, as torches for his lawn. About how they just mowed them down, and whenever they mowed down Christians, more would take their place because there was something otherworldly going on in them to where they would give up their entire lives to put faith in a man that maybe they had never even met. What benefit could they possibly gain from such belief unless they were utterly convinced, unless their lives were transformed by this idea that Jesus really is who he said he is? Because I can tell you, I can try to intellectually convince myself that Jesus is who he says he is, but if all I have done is reasoned it through books and begun to just sort of piece together some sort of investigation, when push comes to shove and somebody puts a gun to my head and says, do you believe that Jesus is who he said he is? And if you say yes, then I'm going to kill you. I don't know if I would have the strength to say yes. That's because the truth of what Jesus claimed, it goes so much further than beyond here. It actually, the Holy Spirit began to move and transform hearts. And this entire movement of people was so convinced in their hearts that there had been this transformation that took place that they were willing to be mowed down by Rome so that others could know who Jesus is because they wanted the world to know who Jesus is. Tertullian was a third century historian. He actually, these are words from him. He says, do your worst.
rack your inventions and tortures for Christians. It is all to no purpose. You do but attract the world and make it fall more in love with our religion. The more you mow us down, the thicker we rise. The Christian blood you spill is like the seed you sow. It springs from the earth again and fruitifies the more. You want to know why I'm convinced that he is who he said he is? Because thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people gave up their lives. The evidence points overwhelmingly to something completely unexplainable. Personal testimonies in history could even point to the lordship of Jesus Christ. But you may say, Pastor, how can I even believe in this Jesus with all this junk that's going on in the world? That's a valid question, one that I may have to address in another sermon at some point. And that's one that's important for the church to continue to address and answer, and we will. What I can tell you, church, is that I'm convinced that Jesus is who he said he is. And it boils down to this. We can't pick and choose parts of who Jesus is. We can't boil Jesus down to just being a good, inspirational teacher. It doesn't cut it. But let me ask you this. How do we treat Jesus in the church? Because I believe that actions dictate more what we believe than anything else. And what I can tell you is that when we encounter Jesus, when we come into his presence, when we worship, when we get together, we kind of treat him as if he is a historical figure, and we kind of talk about him a little bit, and we have these little emotional moments here and there. But I feel like maybe we believe it here. But do we truly approach Jesus in our everyday life as if he really is the Son of God, the Lord, the one who was present in the beginning of creation and the one who makes a way between us and God the Father? Do we truly treat him? Do we come into his presence in awe of who he is? I feel like that statistic that we saw, it creeps into the church. And we want to follow Jesus because he says a lot of good things that make us better people. But I don't want to be better. I want to be transformed. And that only happens when we truly trust that Jesus is 100% who he said he is. So, church, if we've been middling on this, if we've been accepting some of the things that Jesus says and some other things that he hasn't, we really need to put in perspective that the things that Jesus said don't add up unless he's Lord. If we've been middling on this, if we've been on the fence about who Jesus is for a while, you're faced with a challenge. Because I think C.S. Lewis nailed it. We can't pick and choose from who we believe him to be. We can't just say he was a good guy who did and said some good things. He was too radical for us to give him that title. He's either God or he's wrong. The church, who is he to you? Lord, I don't know where we've landed on this, but I know that I can't take you lightly. God, I'm sorry if I have treated you more like a school subject than my God. I'm sorry that if I have ever reduced you to some sort of formula, someone who gives me rules to follow, and God, I'm just trying to live up to some of the things that you said, and I've never really in my heart truly believed that you are everything that you have said you are, to where it compels me to live a completely radical, different kind of life. God, I'm sorry if I've picked and chosen things that you've said, or if I've reduced you to some sort of law or formula or any of those kinds of things. I pray that in these days, Lord, and even in this moment, that the truth of who you are would soak so deep into my heart it cannot be denied anymore. I'm tired of tiptoeing through the minefield of the difficult things that you have said and asked me to do and to accept about who you are. God, I want to be washed completely. I just want to be overwhelmed. I want to drown, Lord, in the truth of who you are so much that I can't exist in the shallow end of my faith anymore. So God, speak. I listen. Compel me, Lord. And may that truth never leave me alone until it becomes real in me. Lord, I thank you for your word, for it penetrates my heart. And Lord, when I accept it, it gives me hope. So I pray these things, Lord, in your holy and precious name. For it is in the wonderful name of Jesus I pray these things together. Church said.
Amen.
Amen. I think it might be appropriate for us to just sing a verse and a chorus. If you know it, 'tis so sweet to trust in Jesus. Just sing a verse and a chorus of that together before we close.
'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more.
Amen. Church, you're loved. You're dismissed. Have a blessed Sunday.